I'm Barbara Walters. Hugh Downs is on vacation, and this is 2020.
On the ABC News Magazine, 2020. Tonight, John DeLorean, maverick automaker. His wife, Cristina, fashion model and aspiring actress. They moved among the stars. Then, last year, October 19th, the good life stopped.
I said, John, and he said, Cristina, and I said, are you all right? And he said, yes, and I said, are you scared? And he said, yes.
He was arrested on cocaine conspiracy charges. His business collapsed. Tonight, on the Barbara Walters 2020 Report, in an exclusive interview, Cristina DeLorean talks with Barbara Walters about the day the dream died. The Oak Ridge Boys. Tight harmony in gospel, country, pop, and rock and roll. Close harmony in business, directing their own conglomerate in broadcasting, publishing, merchandising. John Stossel with the success and the selling of the Oak Ridge Boys.
My mother and the rest of the members of the National Assembly, they were in prison for 2 weeks only before they were executed.
Religious martyrs, the Baha'is, murdered in Iran, their houses destroyed, their graves desecrated, and their bodies marked enemy of Islam. But they won't give up their faith. Bob Brown with the tragedy of the Baha'is, persecuted in Iran in the name of Islam.
Up front tonight, the story of Cristina DeLorean, the beautiful wife of the millionaire auto manufacturer John DeLorean, who was arrested last October on charges of trafficking in cocaine. His wife says she knew nothing about this. But this is the first time Mrs. DeLorean has agreed to be on television to talk about her husband and family. John DeLorean is now out on bail, which was originally set at $10 million. Such was the magnitude of the case. But the story of a man who represented the American dream turned nightmare is also the story of a family. Cristina DeLorean, 33 years old, 25 years younger than her husband, had, until his arrest, a life most anyone would envy. Cristina Ferrare, daughter of a Cleveland butcher, soared to the top of America's modeling world. By 1972, when she was 22, her gorgeous face was seemingly everywhere, in print and on the air.
No song and dance, just great-looking hair.
And 1972 was the year she met and fell in love with John DeLorean, then a vice president and the golden boy of General Motors. He was twice divorced and had something of a reputation as a playboy. Friends said she tamed him. He said, I've never been more in love. Cristina became the mother to DeLorean's adopted son, Zachary, now 11, and the couple had a daughter, Kathryn, now 5 and a half.
Daddy moved your foot?
Yeah.
Cristina continued her career, expanding into acting roles.
You're strong, J.W., and you don't need anything but your own beliefs.
John DeLorean quit General Motors to pursue his dream, building his own automobiles. By last October, the dream was failing. DeLorean's company was going broke. Then on October 19th, a seemingly incredible event. John DeLorean was arrested by federal agents in Los Angeles on charges of setting up a $50 million cocaine deal. Cristina's world was shattered. The family's three homes, including this immense New Jersey estate, had to be pledged as collateral for DeLorean's bail, and in fact may still be lost to creditors from the car company's collapse. Her career plummeted. This role on Fantasy Island, filmed last week for airing in the fall, was her first acting job since John's arrest. Through it all, Cristina has stood by John, maintaining his innocence. We talked in the living room of the couple's Fifth Avenue apartment, where Cristina DeLorean received the first word of her husband's arrest.
First, I laughed. I thought, you know, this is ridiculous. I thought it was all a horrendous mistake.
What did you tell your son in particular?
I said, look, honey, I said, Daddy has been arrested, and I have to go to Los Angeles, and I'm going to bring him home. Well, he totally fell apart. He was so distraught and so angry. He bounced off walls. He rolled on the floor. I couldn't control him. My daughter, she's only five. She's really too young to understand really the seriousness of the implication here. She knew something was wrong. And she looked up at me with these huge eyes, and she says, my daddy in jail. And she couldn't fathom that would happen to her father.
When you first saw your husband, what did you first say to him? What did he say to you?
That was the most painful, most awful experience of the whole ordeal. The first time that I saw him, they brought him into the courtroom, and there was a hush that came over the courtroom, and John walked in, and he was in handcuffs. And that was the single most heart-rending experience that I had, to see him, to see John, because, you know, the father of my children, my husband, my friend, my confidant, my everything in the world, this gentle man in handcuffs. And I remember I couldn't move because my legs felt like water. John looked to me suddenly very old. And I said, are you all right? And he said, yes. And I said, are you scared? And he goes, yes. And when he said that, something snapped inside of me. And I decided, well, all of a sudden I received this great inner strength, and all of a sudden I was the protector. Whereas, you know, I always looked to John to be, he was always there for me. And now I was the one that was doing the protecting, and I was strong. And I said, don't you worry about anything. I said, everything's going to be fine. I said, we'll get you home. Everything will be fine. Don't you worry. I'm here. Your friends love you. I love you. Your friends love you. I love you, and we're behind you all the way.
I want to ask you about your friends, because you had very close friends, and some of them people who were quite well known. What happened with them?
They just disappeared. They stopped calling.
Some of the names that I had read were Johnny Carson, NFL commissioner Pete Rozelle, Frank Gifford, Don Hewitt, the producer of 60 Minutes. These were all friends.
Yes.
Do you see any of them now?
No. I see Joanna Carson. She's a very dear friend, and I love her dearly.
The rest?
They just stopped calling. That doesn't bother me, because it hurts me because it hurts John. You can say and do anything you want to me. Honest to God, it rolls right off my back. But if you hurt what's mine, boy, I'm tough. I can't forgive that.
Before all this happened, did you know that your husband was in financial trouble? Did he confide in you?
Yes.
He did?
Absolutely.
Did you know that things were that tough?
He's had problems with financing the company since its inception. You know, it was 9 years in the making, and every year there was some huge mountain that we had to climb and get over pertaining to money, and he would go get over one hurdle and there would be another one.
We've also heard reports of all kinds of money being taken out of the company, being put in Swiss accounts, all this mysterious money, millions of dollars that have vanished.
They always seem to report just one side of the story. It's my knowledge that they've been investigating these wrongdoings, supposedly or allegedly, and have found to this day nothing wrong. I mean, the company has been audited. He's been audited personally. The company's been audited personally. To this day, they have not found one thing that they can say that he fraudulently did. There's no Swiss numbered account. There's nothing.
Before the arrest, John was taking a great many aspirin.
Yes.
Did he take anything else?
He was taking sleeping pills at night because he couldn't sleep. And after a while, I just said, you know, I'd rather stay up with you all night than for you to be going through these pills. He suffered from terrific headaches, terrible headaches, and he just couldn't sleep.
So you knew that an awful lot was going on, that an awful lot was bothering him?
Yes.
While everything has happened to John, your whole career has fallen apart.
Well, like I said, talk about your major nosedive. Yes, it has. I was at the top of my modeling profession. I've been doing it for 20 years. The last 15 years, I've been at the very top of it, commanding top money. And this is July, and since January, I've had one booking, and I've made $105. $105 since January.
You had television offers, they dried up.
I had two lucrative offers. One was for a perfume, the other was a representation of a food product, which absolutely vanished. No one will have anything to do with me or my name. Not at all.
How have you kept it all together? You're the strong one now. You got two kids. You got parents who worry in California.
Yeah.
How are you doing it all?
Well, I have to honestly say, and I know people are going to go, oh, this is, you know, I have more faith in God and the way he works in my life and in John's life. He's the only thing, the only one who gives me comfort, the only one. I can't tell my friend, I cannot burden my friends with my distress and crying or whatever, because they have problems of their own and they can't feel my pain. So the only person I have to talk to is the Lord, and I do. And he answers me, and he gives me great comfort, and John, too.
John goes to Bible study every week.
Yes.
But did he used to?
No. He made the transition when he was in the facilities at Terminal Island, and I brought him the Bible there, and I said, listen, pal, I said, I want you to read this. I said, you need to turn your energy somewhere else and ask him for help. And believe me, it has. It's made a tremendous difference in our life.
How would you describe your husband?
Bigger than life, compassionate, sensitive.
So let me give you some of the things said about him, written about him.
I know what they are.
All right. His ego's too big. He had lived too high. And this is what caused his downfall.
John has an ego, but I have yet to meet a man who doesn't. John, as far as living too high, he's not flamboyant with his money. He's not, regardless of what they've said in the paper. The money that he's made through real property. He's invested in real estate.
Okay, here we go.
What?
You have a 20-room apartment on Fifth Avenue. You have a 430-acre estate in New Jersey. You have a ranch in San Diego. Your husband worked for General Motors and then, to all intents and purposes, was unemployed or was building up this automobile company. Where'd you get the money to live like this, people ask?
Well, first of all, let me start by saying nobody handed John DeLorean anything. He was born in the ghetto in Detroit. He lived in America. This is supposed to be the land of opportunity. He worked at General Motors for many years and made top money. John has invested his money very well. When people come from nowhere and make money for themselves, why are people resentful of it? Why are they resentful because John's married to a young woman, he's got two kids, we seemingly have had a charmed life. Why are people so angry with that? Nobody gave John anything. He worked for it.
Even so, Cristina, it's such a high lifestyle.
What do you mean a high lifestyle?
Well, I mean, this is one of the most expensive apartments in New York. You dress beautifully. You have jewelry.
I mean,
that costs a lot of money.
I make money. I used to make money. We have no source of income now, and I don't either as of now, and we'll probably have to sell what we have, but that's okay. This is, you buy and you invest for the future in case something disastrous happens. It happened, so we have to sell it.
How has John been spending his time?
Quietly, in the country. He will not leave the country. He's constantly on the phone. He is obsessed with this case. This is all he does, morning, noon, and night.
When he gets depressed, what do?
I try to be funny. I try to tell him not to worry about anything. We pray. I'll cook. I'll do so. You know, I bring the children in because the children are his only source of really great joy and comfort. So we'll do things as a family together.
What do you think happened? Why are you so sure he's innocent?
Because he was undoubtedly framed. There's no question about it. He was framed.
How was he framed? By whom?
I would say by the people involved, the government agents, the people involved in this whole scenario, this whole setup.
John DeLorean's setup for his dream car involved a complicated financing arrangement with the British government that allowed him to build a factory in Northern Ireland. Cristina DeLorean says that British partnership went sour.
We are of the opinion that there was a huge conspiracy involving the British government bringing down the company. And we have, if I may quote something from here, I have it right here under my pillow. It's relating to the time period of September 15th to October 19th, John was arrested on a book that was just released in London, and it's called DeLorean, The Rise and Fall of a Dreammaker. It says here, if I may quote, U.S. diplomatic sources contacted members of the Thatcher government and advised them not to do business with DeLorean. There was no hint of an arrest or of narcotics, just a warning to the wise. It's our opinion that there was a huge conspiracy involved, and this confirms our suspicion.
Don't you think it'll be hard for people to believe that a man could be framed by government agents, that the United States government could be out to destroy him, that this could all be some huge conspiracy?
Absolutely. He's not the first. It's happened before in the past. And yes, I believe that once the facts of the story comes out, they'll believe it.
Even though neither you nor your husband know why this happened?
We don't know why, but it could happen to anybody. It happened to you.
What you're saying is that he was entrapped.
He was framed.
John DeLorean met with federal informants in this Los Angeles hotel. FBI agents videotaped the meetings, and those tapes will figure prominently in his trial.
The picture was that John DeLorean had cocaine in his hand when he was videotaped and said, "This is as good as gold."
It's not true. I saw the tape. That's not true. He didn't bring the cocaine. The government agents that were... I don't want to comment on that. That has to be brought up in court.
Was cocaine involved?
Well, yes, it was involved. But John didn't finance it. He didn't bring it in. It wasn't... He didn't give it to distribute. He didn't finance the deal either. He put up no money for the deal.
But he was supposed to be getting some money from the sale of cocaine.
It was his knowledge he was going to get the money. It was coming through a legitimate transaction through a bank.
Someone said, "Mr. DeLorean, we've got a bank that's going to invest in your company." That's what he thought?
Where the money would come through. It would come through
a bank.
Yeah, I don't think the bank itself was not going to do the investing. The money was coming through the bank.
Did he know that the money was coming from cocaine?
I don't feel that I should be in a position to comment on that. I should leave that up to the lawyers and to John.
Do you think that he should go to jail?
Oh, absolutely not. And I don't believe for one second when the facts come out in this case, then anybody else will think the same thing either.
How do you see the future?
Optimistically. I cannot believe that when there are 12 people on a jury, when they find out what really happened here, I choose to believe that our system of justice works in this country. I choose to believe it. And there's no way that he will ever be found guilty.
John DeLorean goes on trial October 4th. More of this interview tomorrow on Good Morning America. Now, close your eyes. Do you recognize the voice? He's one of the Oak Ridge boys. John Stossel has a profile. But next, Bob Brown with the tragic story of the Baha'is in Iran. They're being killed for their faith, right after this. The Baha'is are a worldwide religious faith. In recent weeks in Iran, 16 members of the Baha'is that we know about were hanged. They were executed in spite of an appeal for clemency by President Reagan. Those killed included 3 teenage girls, plus this entire family. They died in Iran for their faith. And here with a report on this modern-day martyrdom is Bob Brown. Bob?
Barbara, the fundamentalist Muslim government in Iran has displayed an intense hatred of the Baha'is that stems in part from how the tenets of the faith differ from Islam, sometimes radically. Among other things, the Baha'is believe in equality of the sexes, eventual world government, universal education, and in practicing their religion without clergy, all concepts that have infuriated Iran's leaders. In general, the Baha'is practice a gentle faith that advocates meeting violence with serenity. And in Iran today, that tenet of the Baha'i faith is being tested in the extreme. This is a photograph of leaders of the Baha'i faith in Iran, including the entire membership of the Baha'i National Spiritual Assembly. All but one are now dead, executed, or missing and presumed dead.
I was surprised that the execution took place so quickly. My mother and the rest of the members of the National Assembly, they were in prison for 2 weeks only before they were executed.
Ramna Mahmoudi now lives in the United States. Her mother, an Iranian physicist and meteorologist, was killed in December of 1981. Her father, an Iranian television personality, simply vanished a year and a half before her mother's execution.
I don't know who pulled the trigger. a Muslim guard, most likely. Whoever it was, he was doing a job for his government in the name of Islam, for the Islamic government of Iran. And they have no shame to cover that up at all, because we are the infidels.
My father was a doctor, a physician. He was alone in his office, and he was shot by this patient.
He was shot by one of his own patients?
Yes.
Dr. Paul Hakim lives in France. His father, a Baha'i doctor who, he says, treated many Iranian casualties from the war with Iraq, was murdered 2 years ago and mourned by hundreds of his friends at the Baha'i Cemetery in Tehran.
Do you think that the order for your father's execution was handed down by the government of Iran?
A week after, officially from the government, they came to take the house and take everything. That showed that it was maybe a plan, because the old leaders of the Baha'i faith had been executed, had been kidnapped.
Iran's Islamic Revolution under the Ayatollah Khomeini again focused attention and hatred on the 300,000 to 400,000 Baha'is who live in Iran, attacks that followed a long history of persecution. Whereas Christians can freely practice their religion in Iran, and even Jewish ceremonies are tolerated under Muslim rule, Baha'is are denied recognition of their faith, which ironically was born in Iran in 1844.
Baha'is believe their faith grew out of Islam the way Christianity grew out of Judaism. They believe their founder was the most recent of God's messengers on earth, like Moses, Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, a prophet. But Islam recognizes no prophet since Muhammad, and so Baha'is in Iran are denounced as heretics.
The principles of the Baha'i faith, the fact that you have to independently investigate the truth for yourself, you do not need any mullahs, Muslim clergy, to get in touch with God or to go to heaven for that matter, that creates a lot of animosity.
Early Baha'is were chained and persecuted for following the prophet who outlined the principles of the faith in the late 19th century, a man called Baha'u'llah. During one period, 20,000 of those first adherents were put to death, often under the pretext of being agents of the colonial powers who then threatened Persia.
Back then, they were labeled British spies or Russian lackeys. Nowadays, they're called American agents or collaborators with Iraq. But the most troublesome charge of all is that they are instruments of Zionism, because their world center, holiest shrine, and prime place of pilgrimage, by accident of history, is in the state of Israel.
But the Baha'i Center was located here long before the modern Israeli state was founded, because Baha'u'llah, the Baha'i prophet, was ordered into exile to the Holy Land from Iran. He was imprisoned in this jail by the Turks in the city of Akko, in what was then called Palestine. Eventually, his confinement in this prison was relaxed, and he was moved to a nearby mansion where he was kept under house arrest.
There, he wrote, received his followers, and finally was buried in 1892. At that point, a shrine was raised here in nearby Haifa, and the Holy Land became the spiritual center of the Baha'i faith.
In 1953, construction was completed on an ornate dome erected over the shrine. This monument to Baha'ism is one of the most visible landmarks, day and night, in this Israeli city. Don Barrett is an American Baha'i, a former attorney for the Gulf Oil Corporation, who now lives in Haifa and is the Secretary General of the Baha'i World Center.
The Iranian government has charged that because you're in Israel, you were dependent to a certain extent in Israel, and that would at least make you sympathetic to the cause and at worst would make you collaborators with the Israelis. How do you respond to that?
Completely baseless. Baha'is are totally self-supporting. We don't receive nor do we ask for any grants from this government or any other government throughout the world. Our relations here are based on mutual respect. We have friendly relations with this government, as does any Baha'i community anywhere throughout the world.
Baha'ism is a political movement and not a religion. And it has the mosque it has a religious mosque. That's all.
Saeed Rajai Khorasani is Iran's ambassador to the United Nations. A report prepared by the Iranian UN mission claims the charges of persecution of the Baha'is are propaganda, that Baha'ism is not a religion, but a front for enemy agents.
Generally, among the leaders, we had a good number of them who were agents of America or Israel.
And they were executed?
Oh, yes. It had nothing to do with Baha'ism. It just happened that we had among Muslims also people who have been executed.
But in the report that was filed by your mission to the United Nations, though, it mentioned specifically that because the Baha'i World Center was in Haifa, that Israel, which you said was an anti-Islamic power, was therefore the nourishing cradle of Baha'ism.
There is a relation between Israel and Baha'ism, no doubt. We also know that the Baha'i World Center is in Haifa. We have also historical evidence which supports the strong relation between the creation of Baha'ism on the one hand and Zionism on the other hand.
And although Islamic leaders also believe Baha'is strongly supported the Shah of Iran, these radio attacks against the Baha'is were broadcast in 1955, when the Shah was in power and the Baha'i National Center in Tehran was taken over by the army and dismantled piece by piece, with the ceremonial help of Muslim clergymen and officers of the Shah's military. This film, obtained by 2020 through Baha'i contacts, is being seen on television for the first time. The destruction of the center signaled attacks on Baha'i communities, and passions began to cool only after the United Nations and several governments applied diplomatic pressures. After the Islamic Revolution, more destruction. A revolutionary guard standing atop the holiest of all Baha'i shrines in Iran, the house of a merchant in Shiraz, where the foundation of the faith was laid. This 8mm film, smuggled out of Iran at great risk to the photographer, shows the destruction of the house in September of 1979.
Would the Iranian government consider protecting Baha'is if it felt they were in great danger?
It depends. You see, under the law, every people has some protection, depending upon what he is doing and what situation he is. If some people are people who are walking in the street, if they are attacked, of course they are protected. But what do you mean by protection? To what extent? For what? For what sort of activities? Protection has a very
protection in the sense that in 1979, their holiest shrine was dismantled.
The shrine is not considered holy. We take it as a center of conspiracy. Very simple. For this, you have to say there is no protection.
The Baha'is think the executions now are more systematic than in the past. Many bodies have been marked with the term enemy of Islam. Because Baha'i marriages are sometimes not viewed as legal, women may be condemned as prostitutes, children as bastards. These photographs supplied by the Baha'is show what they say are desecrated grave sites. If there is so much hatred and danger, why stay in Iran?
Because when you want to leave Iran, you have to apply for passport. And there is a section which they ask about your religion. And as a Baha'i, you will write Baha'i in it. And as soon as you write Baha'i, the word Baha'i, they don't let you go.
Farid Akhtar Kaveri and his brother, Badi, both have lived in Florida since before the Islamic Revolution. But their mother and father continued to live in Iran. Their father, a merchant and teacher, whose execution order, they claim, was handed down by a student.
As they took him to prison, all he needed was to say that he's not Baha'i. The Revolutionary Guard, they offered my father, we say that you are Zoroastrian, which was my grandfather's previous religion. And my father refused that. And so what had happened, I think a few hours later, they executed him.
After the execution, his house was confiscated, and his widow, Banu Akhtar Kaveri, escaped from Iran. She told us in her native language that before she left, there was one final humiliation. She says the executioners of her husband required that she reimburse them for the bullets.
Is it customary to request that kind of compensation in a situation
this
like
is,
that?
This is irrelevant. If this is customary, it has nothing to do with the boys. It must be, for everybody who is killed, and therefore the family must pay for the bullet. If they don't ask others to pay for the bullets, they don't ask Baha'is either.
Whenever she hears that some Baha'is are executed recently in Iran, she automatically starts crying and she feels much anguish. It reminds her of the scene when she saw her husband.
It is purely and simply religious fanaticism which causes this persecution, and they don't want the world to know it. In fact, in many cases where the Baha'is have been tortured and accused of being spies for Israel or spies for the United States, and yet they can go free if they merely sign a piece of paper saying that they are Muslims and they recant their Baha'i faith. Well, this is obviously the answer to the false charges.
Every week, firesides are held here, Baha'i firesides.